Hi guys, and welcome to Softskins. In this video we'll cover chapter 11, dictionaries from Booktink Python. In the previous one we covered lists, and you can find table comparing lists and dictionaries in this link here, and also some information about tuple and set, when you can use them and the most common operations for them, and also comparison between list and dictionary with most popular operations for them, and also comparison for time complexity for both of them. If you're interested in this information, you can click the link and check it, and also you can bookmark it for further information. And now let's start. First, what is a dictionary? This is a built-in type, and it's a really popular one in many algorithms and also in many solutions in programming. In general, you have keys and values, and these pairs are stored in a dictionary. If you want to create new dictionary, you can use a function dict, or you can use curly brackets, and as you can see, as a result we have two empty dictionaries created. If you want to add element to this dictionary, then you can use square brackets, the key, and the value for your new element. In this case, we create a new item in this dictionary with key 1 and value 1. We can check the output, and you can see that this information is presented with colons. If we do the same operation by giving the same key, but this time different value, we will have updated value for this key. And this is important for dictionaries to know that you can have only one unique key for a given dictionary. And this is how you can use them. And let's see how we can create dictionary with more items. In this case, we are creating a dictionary with 3 pairs, and we can see this information here. And what is going to happen if we try to use this? Can you try to guess what is going to be the output? And as you can see, right now we are providing 2 keys. When we are trying to create new dictionary, we have 2 times one and the same key, but in the output we have only once this key with the latest value. So this is how dictionaries are working if you are trying to preserve one key with several values. And let's see what information do we have here. I will restore the previous value, and as you can see, if you want to access the value for this key 2, you can use again curly brackets, and you'll get the value which is mapped to this key. If you are trying to do the same for key which is not existing in this dictionary, for example 4, you'll get an error. And this is key error, which is frequent one for beginners in Python. If you want, you can find what is the length of items in your dictionary by using built-in function len, and also you can use in operator, which we saw in the previous video, and we can see do we have this key 1, and as we can see we have 1 in this dictionary, and we don't have 1 in the same dictionary. You can also get the values for a given dictionary by using built-in function values, and again you can use this list of values to check do you have this value in the lists or not. And as you can see, we have 1, which is present in the values but not in the keys. If you want to get values, you can use built-in function values. For the keys you can use keys, and if you want to get both of them, you can use items. And this is the output. You have values, you have keys, and you have the items, and you can find them how they are printed in pairs, the key and the value. If you want to understand how dictionary is defined and how it's working, you can check these bonus links For example, here you have a hash function, you have some input values, and you have hash code or hash values. You need to remember that these hash codes should be unique, and also this hash function have a lot of other properties, which you can find in this article here and also in the other ones. So let's imagine that we have a problem for a given string to find how many times a given letter appeared in this string. There are many ways to solve this problem, and you can find some of them here. One of them is to create 26 variables, and each time a character is presented in this string, to increment the counter for the given variable. You can use a list, create indexes by converting the character to a number by using function ORT, and then you can use again the counters. And finally, you can use this new built-in type dictionary and increment the counter only if you meet a given element. You can find an example function here, which is implementing this requirement with a dictionary. So first we are going to define a dictionary, then we are going to iterate through all characters in this string. Finally, we are going to check, do we have this character in the dictionary? If not, we are going to start the count with 1. If this character was present in the string, then we are going to increment by 1. And let's check what is the result for Brontosaurus. You can find that we have B1 and R is found 2 times in this string. The same is O, it's found 2 times, and so on. You can find how the function is working if you provide only 1 character, and you can see that we have 1. Also, you can use default values. In this example, if you try to get information from your dictionary by using a built-in method get, and this is present in the dictionary as a key, then you get the value for this dictionary. If the key is not present in this dictionary, you can use default value with comma and the default value, and then you get the default value. Otherwise, if you're trying to get the value with the old way, we are going to get key error. If you're trying to get the value with square brackets, let's try it. And this is how you can prevent errors like this when you're working with dictionaries, using default method with get. And for example, can you rewrite this histogram function by not using if, but using this get function? This is an exercise, and one possible solution for this is by using for, then we're trying to get the value, providing 0 as default and increasing the number for each letter. And let's check what is going to be the output. And as you can see, right now we have the same output as before. If you want to loop through dictionaries, then you can use for loop, and you can provide variable. And let's check what is going to be the output for this function. You can find that we are iterating through this dictionary, and we are getting all the keys in this variable. In this case, we will get the key, and then we are going to access the value for each of the keys. Finally, we are printing them. So for parrot, we are starting with P, creating new record for P, and then we are continuing with all the rest. And finally, you can find how many times we are matching each of those words in this string. And if you notice something, the values are not sorted, and this is because dictionary is created in this way. You have indexes which are not sorted naturally, and you're creating your indexes by yourself. If you want to do some sorting, you can use built-in function sorted, as in this example here. So we're going to get key from the sorted keys, and then we're going to print the outputs. And as you can see right now, we have parrot, and all the keys here are how they are appearing in the original string, and here they are sorted in alphabetic order. And this is one important feature for dictionaries. It's not easy to say which is the first key and which is the last one. You might do it in some ways, but it's not always possible and it's not good practice. And as a bonus, if you want to get the keys and the values in for loop, you can use this structure here. So you can use items, then present key, comma value, and you can print them. And as you can see, we have the same output as here. So this is how you can write the same thing in a shorter way. And we saw what is a lookup. This is when you're trying to get a value by the key. And reverse lookup is when you're trying to do the reverse operation, when you're trying to get the key for a given value. But as you can think, we have several problems. You might have one value which has which is presented for more than one key, or also you might have a missing value. And in order to deal with these situations, we can build a function like this, which is implementing search pattern. And you can find that we're going through all keys in this dictionary. Then we're checking, do we have value for this key? And if this is the case, we're going to return the key. If not, we're going to output an error. And let's try what is going to happen if we are trying to search for value 2 when we're building histogram for parrot. And as you can see, we have R. And if you're if you have any doubts why we are searching for 2 in parrot, this is because histogram is creating dictionary with letters and values. So we have value 1, value 1 again, and 2 for R. We're trying to get values for 2. In this case is war, because it's found 2 times in this string. If we are trying to get, do we have 3 times any letter in this string, we'll get error, as you can find. But as you can see, this error is not really informative. And in order to make it a bit more informative, you can change the way you're raising the error by providing some information in the error. You can find it here. So you're raising, this is error which you're building, and then you're providing information which is helping the user to find what is the problem, and this is going to appear in the final error. And now it's much better if you're trying to compare with this one here. And now let's speak about another problem, which is about dictionaries and lists. For example, if you are given a dictionary which have for keys letters and values frequencies, if you want to invert it, then you need to build a function like this one here. And then you need to go through all keys, then get the value, and then create new record for this new dictionary which you're creating here, which is inversed. And this is how inverting a dictionary is working. And let's check what is the output here. You can find that we are starting with this histogram which we saw in the previous example, and then we have key, and we have a list for element for this dictionary. This means that because we can have more than one letter which is found one time in this string, then we need to build this key with value which is a list, and this is perfectly fine for dictionaries, to have for values list, dictionary on or any other object. And this is where the power of dictionaries is. And what is going to happen if you are trying to provide list for key but not for a value? As you can guess, we are going to get an error because list is not hashable, and in general list can be changed and it's mutable. Because of this, we are not sure what is going to be the value in this list, and we are not having good key because the key might be missing or we might have duplications in these keys, and that's why it's not possible to use list as a key, but you can use it as a value, as you can see here. And now let's continue with memos and memoization. If you remember, we worked with Fibonacci in chapter 6 and we found how to calculate each number for this sequence. By default, we were using a simple function which was using recursion. And this is very inefficient if you're trying to calculate big numbers. One way to optimize this is to build dictionary with known elements, and each time when we are trying to calculate Fibonacci for new n, to store the current elements which are calculated. In this way, we are going to calculate each number only once and not many times. And let's compare this implementation of Fibonacci with the old one. And now we're calculating Fibonacci for 20 by, this is the using dynamic programming with memoization, and as you can see we have nanoseconds. By using our old approach we have milliseconds, and as you can see the new way it's much faster. If you are trying to calculate this for bigger numbers, the difference is going to increase a lot. And here I want to recommend to read this wiki page for dynamic programming, and also to check this playlist with dynamic programming, which is really interesting. It's from MIT. It's a series from several lectures, and also the presenter of this lecture is a really nice guy, so I highly recommended this video and this video series. And now let's say some words for global variables. Let's have a variable like this and one function. If we are trying to access the function in this, to access the variable in this function, it's pretty fine. We can get the value and we'll get what we expect from this function. Let's check. As we can see, we are having access to this variable and oh, it's okay. But what is going to happen if we are trying to change the value for this global variable in the function? If you're guessing that we'll get true, you're wrong, because we have false. Because we are using global variable and we are not allowed to change this global variable inside the function. If you want to change this variable in the function, then you need to declare it with global, and now you can change it. And let's check the output, but as you can see right now we have false. Can you pause the video and try to guess why we have false? And this is going to test your problem solving at least a bit. And the problem is that we are not calling this function, and this might be a problem sometimes, and that's why you need to be sure how to solve some problems like this and investigate the code for yourself. And let's go back to our global variables. You can also define a global variable outside a function, and then you might try to increment the variable inside. And this is not working, as you can see, because this is not considered as already defined. In order to use it, you need to again use global, and only once this is working fine. For example, if we're trying to execute this function, always fine. And you can find how we can do the same with dictionaries, but if you're using dictionary for global variable, this is going to work because you're changing the values for this dictionary and not the value of the variable known in this case. And as you can see, if you're using dictionary for global variable, you can modify some of the values of this dictionary, which is not the same for the other global variables. And also you can find the difference if we are calling the function and we are not calling the function, because without calling this function, we are redefining this dictionary again, and that's why here we have result without two. And only when we are calling again the function, we'll have output with key 2. And this is really interesting fact and something you need to remember when you're working with dictionaries and also in programming, that calling a function might have a huge impact on your program. And finally, let's say some words about debugging and some tips how you can work with bigger datasets, because it's not easy and sometimes senior programmers might have problems with this. So you can find several points here. First, you can scale down the input. For example, if you have 5000 records, you can work only with 5 and then continue with the rest of the examples when you're sure that the program is working fine for the first examples. You can also check summary for your data and some summarization. For example, what are the most frequent types or most frequent errors for this code. And this is also a really powerful thing. Another one is to use self-checks. For example, sanity check or consistency. You can find explanation here in this cell. And finally, you can format the output if you have many errors in order to understand better what is going on. And let's do a quick demo for this. We have a working dataset with 5000 rows with 30 columns. And let's say that I want, let's check what is the data first. As you can see, we're having only 5 rows here because it's not really easy and convenient to show them in the browser, 5000. And let's say that I want to calculate the total amount for likes for this column here. And I can use something like sum and getting all the likes in this way. And as you can see, I get none values, which is not expected for me. If I go through all 5000 records, this is not convenient and it's not easy to be used. And that's why I can use something like summary and getting all frequencies for the values. I can see that I have 0 values 907 times, and I have values which are none. Those values are not applicable for my operation and they're corrupting my output. That's why I can use something like viewNA and provide default value for these missing values, and now I can see it's working fine. But what about if I want to do division by duration and then likes? As you can see, now we have none values, but also we have something else, which is division by zero. And this is again causing a problem for me. That's why I need to investigate all errors like this, remove the errors, and only then I can get proper value for my outputs. And this is how you can work with debugging for your programs. Scaling down the input, checking some summaries, writing some self-checks, for example, checking that you don't have value which is outside the minimum or maximum, and finally you can format the output. Thank you for watching. This is the finish for this chapter. I will try to do the next in the next weeks. Thank you also for the good words. If you have any ideas or suggestions, as always, you can put them in the comment section below. Thank you for watching and have a good day.